Good morning and happy Sabbath. We want to welcome those that are online, those that are here in our audience. We're so happy that you could join us. And we're so happy that you're here today with us. I am your host, Georgia Wright.
And I'm your host, Brother Peter Lewis. And we want to thank you for joining us here at Toronto Central for our Divine Worship Service.
Peter, Psalms 37, verse 7 said, "Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him." I pray that we take this opportunity to rest in the Lord today.
Praise God for the Sabbath. Praise God for rest.
And we want to encourage you to continue to subscribe to our YouTube page and to press that like button so that the word can go out and others may come to know Jesus Christ.
We here at Toronto Central believe in the importance of social media in advancing our ministry and connecting with our community.
You know, Peter, on Wednesday night, Sister Marcia McLaren talked about how someone had sent the link to her, and that's how she became a member. And she encouraged us to continue to send the link to each and every one of us. We want to see everyone saving God's kingdom.
Amen. And I bet you there are much, much more stories just like the one you just told.
Correct. And today, as usual, we'll be celebrating those who have birthdays.
Amen. In the midst of the pain and trials and struggles in life, it's important to celebrate moments of joy.
Exactly. And before we do that, Peter, we always repeat something that we at Central here believe in. And what is it that we usually say?
Well, hold on first. The title of today's sermon is Living on the Edge, and it'll be spoken by Pastor Damson Oppong.
Oh, yes, that is correct. So stay tuned. I'm sure you're in for a blessing.
Amen. And our motto is?
Where Jesus?
We are central.
Where Jesus is central.
And people care about people.
Care about people.
Be blessed.
Are they running the video?
Let me say happy Sabbath to everyone worshiping with us today, and want to extend my personal welcome to you all. Welcome on behalf of our pastoral staff and leaders. It's great to see you here worshiping with us, and it's good to have those online worshiping with us as well. We just want to thank God for his amazing goodness and grace in allowing us, even in a time like this, to be able to worship him, to come together, and to give him praise. Today is a Sabbath day. We've been studying our lesson this week, and we have learned so much more about the importance and the benefits of the Sabbath as we take time out to rest from our labors and to give God the praise, the honor, and the glory. So let us relax, let us just open our hearts to receive the word of God. Let's just open our hearts to allow God to do something new and something special in our lives as we endeavor to make him first choice and the priority of our hearts. So I greet you with Jesus' joy and hope that we'll have a wonderful day today. I just want to say thanks to all our leaders, elders, to Pastor Dunchy and all the team of individuals working behind the scene and working up front in keeping things together, even during my absence, and continue to do so that on times like these, on Sabbaths like these, all will go well. And I just want to say thanks very much. Let us continue, brothers and sisters, to keep our loved ones who have lost, our members who have lost loved ones in our prayer. We just want to mention, last week we forgot to mention Sister Desiree and her brother who lost their father, and just want to let you know that we continue to keep you in prayer, as we know these are hard times, especially to lose a loved one. Many of us have had reports of individuals passing, friends, family members. Yesterday, I got the dreaded news of a colleague of mine who passed, and continues to play some role in my whole spirit, and we know that in these times, it's very hard when we hear of sudden death, as it were, of individuals whom we relate to closely. So let's keep all these families in prayer, because we know this is a challenging time, but in all of that, God is amazing, God is good. I just want to remind us that our evangelistic series we are preparing for a grand evangelistic series beginning on the 16th of October. Please keep that in mind. We are living in the time where people need to hear the word of God more than ever before. And so let us do our part to spread the news, spread the word around, and so that we will be able to have individuals come and hear the word of God and accept Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. So our series begins October 6th, and you will be hearing more on that as time goes on. Just want to remind you that this evening at 6:30, we'll be having a special Bible class with Pastor Dr. Reynold Hazelwood, as he will be leading us through our Bible class this evening at 6:30. You cannot afford to miss it. So please remember to come online. It's our Bible class, Sabbath School Zoom app or Zoom link that we use, and we hope to see you all at that time. I want to encourage us, let us continue to be buoyant as it relates to our Wednesday night prayer meeting. We don't want that to go back to where it has been. We have developed a good thing together on our Wednesday night. It's such a blessing, our Wednesday night prayer meeting. The music, the testimony, the preaching, the prayer, all this is so, so good to help us carry on during the week. So let us share our prayer meeting Zoom link with others. Let's encourage others to join. As members, let's join. Let's tell our friends. Some of us have individuals who are not members, and they will be blessed as well. So share it so that we can have a good gathering on our Wednesday night prayer meeting. I just want to wish you all a very blessed and happy Sabbath. Today is a very special day. We'll be having a baptism service shortly, and it's our hope that everything today will bring honor and glory to Almighty God. We'll receive His tremendous blessing, and we leave here today rejoicing in the name of the Lord. Or we will close our computer or sign out from our laptop or phone or whatever, praising God for what He has done for us. God bless you, and have a wonderful Sabbath.
Once again, the psalmist David reminds us that the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. Day unto day uttereth speech, night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. And for that we want to praise God, because it says, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. Testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. Praise be to God. This is our call to worship.
Let us sing, fill this place.
Sing today, may you come and fill this place. Father, may you let your Holy Spirit have thy own way. Be with each and every one who shall hear your word today. Thank you, Lord, for hearing. Thank you for answering. And thank you for your promise. For a blessed day, I pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. Let us all stand as we sing our opening hymn, 183. I will sing of Jesus' love. I will sing.
I will say.
such love is sown.
Such love is sown, Lord, I own. My heart is won. Help me now, my love to show.
I will sing of Jesus' love and his praise. Praise.
My heart shall give, he has done. Then on my lips I will sing his love to me.
Amen. You may be seated.
Baptism today, and we would like to do the vows for them at this time. So I'm going to invite the candidates to come. We have Sister Joanna Bentham, who is getting baptized today, and today is your birthday, Joanna. Amen. And we also have Sister Joyce Lynn Sylvester. We're going to ask you to just stand right where you are. Just stand right there. Just stand right there. And we're going to invite our head elder, Elder Green, to do the vows at this time. Thanks.
Praise be to God. Heavens rejoice at this moment. We want to congratulate you too, and I hope and trust that God's hands will always lead you in the path of righteousness. I'd just like to read the vow to you. It's three, short version of our baptismal vow. It says, if you want to answer in the affirmative of holding your hands up or say I do, you can do so. Okay, it says, do you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and Lord, and do you desire to live your life in a saving relationship with him? Amen. Do you accept the teaching of the Bible as expressed in the statement of fundamental belief of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and do you pledge by God's grace to live your life in harmony with his teaching? Amen. The last one says, do you desire to be baptized as a public expression of your faith in Jesus Christ, to be accepted into the fellowship of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and to support the church and its missions as faithful steward by your personal influence, tithes, an offering, and a life of service to God? Amen. Viewers and audience, you have heard the vow that they have just taken. They accepted these vows. So at this time, I would like someone to make a motion so that we can have these folks baptized as an expression of their faith. Can someone so move? Is it second? Second. All those who are in favor to see these lovely folks, two ladies, get baptized as an expression of their faith in Jesus Christ, can we all raise our hands? Amen. Praise the Lord. Any opposed? No, I didn't think so. Once again, we want to welcome you into our fellowship. May God richly bless you as you share your faith with others. At this time, Sister Sylvester and Sister Joanna Bentham would like for you just to turn around so that the folks can see you. Amen. Amen. Is Elder Brown here? Okay, let us pray on their behalf. Let's bow heads. Oh, great God and our Father in heaven, this morning is a very special morning because we have witnessed two dear loved ones who have made the vow to follow you all the way to baptism. I pray, oh God, that you may enter into their hearts at this time. Speak to them, Lord. Remind them of your promise. because you have promised not to leave them nor forsake them, but you will always be there and near to them in their journey in and out. I pray, O God, that thy spirit may overflow them with the spirit of love, joy, peace, and a life of service to men and to you. Bless them, Lord. Bless the family. And I pray that soon and very soon, we all will see the fruits of our labor, because when everything is said and done, it will be God and God alone. Bless them in a very special way, we pray, for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Hello, boys and girls. This is Aunt Fernita, and I have a wonderful story for you called Pillars of Cloud and Fire. Today's memory verse is from Genesis chapter 28, verse 15. It says, "I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go." The message for today's story is we thank God for taking good care of us. Have you ever been lost? The Israelites didn't get lost because they had two things to lead them. Many years had passed since Pharaoh's daughter had found Moses in the basket by the edge of the river. While Moses lived with his family, his parents taught him to know and love God. When he was about 12 years old, he went to live with the Pharaoh's daughter in the king's palace. Moses had grown to be a wise man, and God had chosen him to lead the Israelites away from the cruel Pharaoh in Egypt to a better land. When the Israelites left Egypt, they crossed the Red Sea and soon found themselves in a desert. What is a desert like? It's very hot and dry and full of sand, very hot during the day and very cold at night. Wild animals lived there, and even Moses wasn't sure which way they were to go. But God had a special plan to keep them safe and to make sure they wouldn't get lost. God led them in a wonderful way. During the daytime, the Israelites could see above them a huge cloud rising up like a pillar into the sky. When the cloud moved forward, the Israelites moved with it, for God was in the cloud leading them. But the cloud did more than just to show them where to go. During the heat of the day, the cloud gave the Israelites shade to keep them cool. It protected them from the burning sun. But at night, when it was cold and dark, a cloud wasn't much good. Then the Israelites needed light and warmth. And that's when the huge cloud became a pillar of fire. The fire gave them light at night. It also helped to keep them warm in the cold desert. And it scared away the wild animals that might try to hurt them too. God had come up with the perfect way to protect and lead his people. Day or night, the Israelites could always see that God was leading them and keeping them safe. They knew he was protecting them, and they praised him for his care. We can thank God for taking care of us too. He watches over us and leads us every day. And although we don't see a cloud or fire, we know God still protects us. Let's remember to thank him for taking good care of us.
This podcast was brought to you by gracelink.net and Studio El Piso. For more children's resources, please visit gracelink.net.
We are going to be having our baptism service done at this time, and I see our pathfinders are here in honor of the baptism of Sister Joanna, who is one of our pathfinders. And so they will be forming an honor guard for her. Our praise team able to take us through some singing at this time. Space. So in the pool with Pastor Kirk Dunche is Sister Joanna Bentham. Her parents and siblings are here, and I'm going to invite them to come up where they can get a closer view. I know some of her siblings, two of her siblings are in the Pathfinder honoring her. And so where's Sister Bentham? Oh, she's doing duties behind. So that's okay. Mommy wants to make sure everything goes well, even on behind the scene. We give God thanks for Sister Joanna's commitment. She wanted to be baptized earlier this year, but then she decided she would wait until her birthday, seeing that her birthday is on a Sabbath. And that's a very good thing to do. She was born physically on the 4th of September, and she will be reborn spiritually on the 4th of September. To God be the glory. And so, my dear beloved Sister Joanna Bentham, because of your love for Jesus Christ and your commitment to walk with him all the days of your life, as ministers of the gospel, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, and the name of the Son, and in the name of the blessed Holy Spirit. Let God's people say, Amen. So in the pool, we have Sister Joycelyn Sylvester. She has been attending our congregation just prior to the lockdown. And we thank God for his leading in her life. And now she has surrendered to go all the way with Jesus. What do you say? We give God thanks for you, Sister Sylvester, and because of your love for Jesus Christ and your commitment to walk with him as you go through the watery grave of baptism to rise to walk in the newness of life. We, as ministers of the gospel, now baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the blessed Holy Spirit. Let the church say, Amen. Let the church say amen. To God be the glory. Great things he hath done. Just want to let you know that our baptism pool is always ready when you are ready to walk with Jesus. And you may have a friend. You may be here and you have not yet decided to make that commitment. We want to let you know that you can still allow the Holy Spirit to lead you. And just in case there's somebody here who have not yet been baptized, but you want us to keep you in our prayers that one day, by God's grace, you too will enter the pool of baptism to walk with Jesus. Is there a hand? Is there a hand? There may be somebody online, and you're looking forward to the day when you will get baptized. You may want to raise, I may not see you, but I know there's some hand raised somewhere. Thank you. There's a little hand up front. Let the little children come to me. Suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, says Jesus. May God bless you all as we continue to worship him.
Sleep is gone, my heart is full of sorrow. I can't believe how much I've let you down. I dread the pain that waits for me tomorrow, when the sun reveals my broken dreams shattered on the ground. Lord, please forgive me. I need your grace to make it through. All I have is you. I'm at your mercy. Lord, I'll serve you until my dying day. Help others find their way at your mercy. Please forgive me. I can't believe the God of earth and glory would take the time to care for one like me. But I read in the Bible that old story, yes, where he bled for my forgiveness while he was dying on the tree. So please forgive me. I need your grace to make it through. All I have is you. I'm at your mercy. Lord, I'll serve you until my dying days. Help others find their way at your mercy. Please forgive me. I need your grace to make it through. All I have is you. I'm at your mercy. I'll serve you until my
Let us pray. Our God and our eternal Father and friend, we thank you for your love and for your awesome goodness towards us. As we come this morning into your courts, into your presence where there is fullness of joy, we are so grateful for the opportunity that you have given us to come. O God, this morning, as I bow on behalf of your people, I ask you in a very special way that you will cleanse me from within. Put aside anything that is unlike you that is within me. And Lord, as I bow, as I lift up my voice before you, Lord, will your blessing come down upon us today. O God, the world is in trouble. There's confusion everywhere. Pestilence is upon the land. But we know, God, that nothing takes you by surprise. O God, we are living in prophetic times. And so, Lord, as your people, I ask you in a very special way that you will help us to look up because our redemption draws at night. Help us, Lord, to hold on to your unchanging hands. Help us, Lord, lest we hold you, God, and we seek to let go in these challenging times. Hold us in the hollow palm of your hands. Father, as we come, I present before you the young people of our church, of our community, and of our nation. The enemy seek to devour them. The enemy have them tossed in to and fro. But great God, I pray, Lord, that you will speak even now through your divine Holy Spirit to a prodigal daughter, to a prodigal son, to come home before it shall be eternally too late. O God, I present this land, the governments in your hand. O God, you said, Lord, if they should turn from their wicked ways, humble themselves and pray, then you will heal the land. Have mercy upon this land, O God. Have mercy upon the leaders, Lord. Speak to them through your divine Holy Spirit and help them to listen to your voice, O God, so that the nation can be a better one. In a very special way, God, I present Jamaica before you. Oh God, from that little place where I am from, Lord, people are dying left, right, and center because of this pestilence. Oh God, I pray that you will help your people to heal to you, Jesus, and to look to you, oh God. So, Lord, it will be well after all. Father, I come back home. I present before you those in the congregation, Lord, that are mourning and are going through the time of bereavement at this moment. I ask you in a very special way, Lord, that you will comfort their souls, O God, and you will help us all to remember that there is coming a day when there will be no more death. There is coming a day, Lord, when you will wipe all tears from our eyes. And there will be peace, sweet peace forevermore with you, my Savior. So have your own divine way with us until then. O God, I present before you those that have their requests in the chat. Those that are visiting with us online, O God, I pray that you will give them a special blessing today. And Lord, you will help them too, those that have not surrendered themselves unto you, to do so before it is a time of too late. Lord, today you have prepared for us, your servant. I pray in a very special way that you will anoint him, O God, and that the message that will come to us will come directly from your throne, and we will go home rejoicing, looking forward to that day when we will be in rest with you. Lord, continue to have your divine way with us. Continue to bless us. Continue to keep us. We thank you. We praise you for who you are. We thank you for all that you have done for us. And we thank you for what you're about to do and will continue to do for us. This is my prayer. In Jesus' awesome name I pray. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, Church. We have now reached the part of the service where we can all participate. It is time for our tithes and offering. In Mark chapter 12, verses 41 to 44, we read about the story about the woman with the two mites. Here's what it says. Now Jesus sat opposite the treasury and saw how people put money into the treasury, and many who were rich put in much. Then one poor widow came and threw in two mites. So he called his disciples to himself and said to them, "Assuredly, I say to you that this poor widow has put in more than all those who have given to the treasury. For they all put in out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, put in all that she had, her whole livelihood." I think this story tells us a very important lesson. There were many people who put in so much money in the treasury, but they didn't give it from their heart. They just gave all that money because they wanted to look good. They wanted to show off. But here comes this poor woman. She only has two coins, but she still gave it to God. She gave from her heart. That's the kind of person you should be, one who gives from the generosity of your heart. God doesn't ask much from us, just 10% of our weekly income, and he will reward us greatly. Malachi 3 verse 10 says, "God will pour out for you such a blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it." Wouldn't you like to be blessed? Then please give a hearty offering. You can also give online at torontocentralsda.com by following what you see on your screen now. Your tithes and offerings can be used for many things around the church, such as building repairs and department funds. You can select to donate to a specific department if you donate online. May God bless you. Please stand as I pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for food, water, shelter, and all that you've done for us. Now, God, as we collect the tithes and offering, I pray that it goes to a worthy cause. Bless those who gave. Bless those who weren't able to give. Be with us all. I pray in your name. Amen.
Through so many dangers and toils of this life, I have already come. But he keeps on giving the grace and the strength to just keep pressing on. He's given a promise, and I am gonna stand on every word his holy word says, and holding his hand, I'll never fear whatever lies ahead. That he for my good. He walks beside me, and heaven is in my view. Oh, I'm gonna make it through.
In spite of the good intentions I've had, sometimes my strength can fail. And though I have tried the very best that I could, my weaknesses prevail. But then I remember the promise he's made. In my weakness, he steady hands will lead me on and on and on.
I'm gonna make it. He's already said that I would. I'll keep on trying. That he's working everything for my good. He walks beside me, and heaven is in my view. Oh, I'm gonna make.
Church. Happy Sabbath. I am so happy to be here. And to all our viewers online, it is good to be in the house of the Lord. Our scripture reading is taken from John 10, verse 10. And the thief cometh not but to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. This is the reading of God's holy word.
Before I introduce the speaker, I'd just like to do a little pastoral assignment. Next week, our students will be returning to school. For many, it's a new experience. Some will be going off to university. And I just want to, at this time, say a prayer for our students. Some will be entering school for the first time in JK. Some will be entering grade one. Some will be entering high school for the first time. New experiences. In fact, it will be a new experience, I assume, for everyone, because at least they'll face a new teacher. And so I just want to lift up our children, our parents also. And so I'm going to invite those who are here to stand with me. And if you're online, to assume an attitude of prayer as we ask God's blessings and guidance on our children. Let us pray. Can we stand, please? O God, our Heavenly Father, you who have led us in the past and have promised never to leave us nor forsake us, we come before you today with a great assurance that your guidance, your grace, your goodness will continue to be with us. In a very special way at this time, Father, as the new school year begins, we want to lift up before you and to present to you our young people, our children, our students who will be going off to elementary, to junior high, to high school, to college, to university. Oh, we pray, Lord, that you will give them the courage, the strength, the fortitude that they will need to stay the course and be successful. Every parent is sending their child to school with the hope that they will do well. That's the aim. I pray, Father, that you will bless their brain cells, touch them, give them the right attitude to listen and to understand and to put in practice what they have learned. Help them, Lord, to do what they need to do so that you can bless them. Because, Lord, we know that when we do our part, you add blessings to it. So I pray, Father, that you will comfort them, you will be with them as they go into a new environment. And Lord, they are going to be bombarded with possible new friends. I pray, oh Father, that you will guide them, that their companions and friends will lead them closer to you. I pray, Lord, that you will help them to stand out as leaders, as young as they may be, that they may be an example to others around them, to their entire class, and even to their teachers. Especially I pray for the parents. We know some are facing this new school year with trepidation, but I ask, Lord, that you will comfort them, bless them in every way, bestow upon them all the graces and the blessings that they need to support their children in every way. And Father, last but not least, I pray for the teachers. The teachers in our schools, the teachers in all the schools. Some are even members of our congregation. I pray, Father, that you will bless them, give them wisdom, give them understanding. They are dealing with a new norm. Help them, Lord, to do so effectively. And at the end, may praise and honor and glory be given to you for what you are doing day by day in our lives. And Father, we look forward to that day when we will enter our heavenly school to learn eternal things, to learn from you and to know more of you. These mercies we humbly ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. Be seated, please. It is my joy to introduce and present our speaker for today. He's no other than Pastor Damson Oppong. He was born in the beautiful country of Ghana. And as we relate to him, he has so much stories to tell us about his growing up years in Ghana. He has traveled widely across Europe and other continents. He has studied for a while at Northern Caribbean University in Jamaica, completed his course of study in England, where he was residing. He has been serving the Ontario Conference for a number of years, serving the Ghanaian church for approximately 14 years. And he has also served at Ruth Seventh-day Adventist Church. Currently, he is the Ministerial Secretary of the Ontario Conference. In other words, he's my boss. And so I'm delighted to have him here today to present a word from the Lord. He's married. His lovely wife, Linda, is not here. And he is also known to be, like Abraham, the father of many sons. He has three sons. So oftentimes I refer to him as Father Abraham. We welcome you, Pastor, and we know that God has laid on your heart a message for us today. We pray that God will open our ears and our hearts to receive the word of God, which is entitled Living on the Edge. And just before Pastor Oppong comes to speak to us, we'll be blessed with musical rendition to prepare our hearts for God's word. Our praise team will bless us with singspiration.
Happy Sabbath again, church. We want to raise a praise today and sing about how God is our strength, strength like no other. I don't know how many of you have prayed for strength before because you needed it at some point, but I know that God answers our prayers, and even for strength, He answers that prayer. So today, I hope that you're able to pray for strength to make it through this new school year, to make it through this new year that's coming up soon, or whatever you're going through, because the Lord is our strength. Amen. You are my strength, strength like no other, strength like no other reaches me. Come on, sing with me. You are my strength.
You are my strength,
strength like no other,
strength like no other,
strength like no other,
strength like no other.
Said it
reaches to me.
You are my hope.
You are my hope.
Hope like no other.
Hope like no other.
Hope like no other.
Hope like no other.
Said it
reaches to me.
In the fullness.
In the fullness.
the power.
In the power of your name.
You lift me
you
up.
Lift
yes.
me up.
Higher and higher.
You lift me up.
Unfailing love. Stronger than mountains.
Stronger than mountains.
Deeper than oceans.
Deeper than oceans.
Said it reaches.
Reaches to me.
Unfailing, unfailing love.
Unfailing love.
Stronger than mountains.
Stronger
yes.
than mountains.
Deeper than oceans.
Deeper than oceans.
Oh, said it reaches.
Of your grace
in the power
of your
said
name.
You lift me up
you lift me up
higher and higher
you lift me up in the fullness of your grace
in the power
of your name
you lift me
you lift me
my strength.
You are my strength.
Oh, you're my strength, yes.
Strength like no other.
Strength like no other.
Strength like no other.
Oh, said it reaches,
reaches
to me. Hallelujah. The Lord is our strength like no other. And because he is our strength like no other, we want to give him our total praise. Feel free to do the actions of the song where it says, lift up my eyes, lift up your eyes, or lift up your hands to Christ today. Amen. Lord, I will lift. His peace. I will lift.
Lord, I will lift
my eyes.
But you know, sometimes when it gets to praise time, I get so engrossed in it that when it's cut short like this, I know time is gone. I really felt, well, do we really need a sermon? Maybe I could do with more praise. But we have to also dig into the Word of God. Happy Sabbath, everyone. It's good to be here, to be invited by my good friend, Pastor Joel Nemhard. He talks about me being his boss. No, he has been my boss for many years. I have literally picked a lot of things from him as a pastor over the years. And he has been a great friend. It's the assignments, you know, the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Today you are arranged here, you are assigned to do this. The next week you are moved to do that. And so it's a great honor to be in this church. And I just want you to know that, you know, you have one of the best in the conference at this church. You are blessed. You are blessed to have him here. And I'm glad that, you know, the Lord continues to bless him and his wife. They just celebrated the anniversary. May the Lord richly bless you as you blossom into the wonderful couple that you are. Well, I also want to acknowledge Pastor Kirk Dunchy. Pastor Dunchy came to this church, and I believe he got married here, and he has a baby here. So Central has been good to him. You have been good to him. You know, it's a blessing. Central always, you know, at Ruth, Central and Ruth always had something, a connection, a deep connection. I always acknowledge Elder Hal Green knows, and Ruth Church was blessed by Central many, many, many times and many years to come. And you know, Elder Hopton is here and he's smiling. He knows why he's smiling, because there was something between Central and Ruth for baptismal numbers. And I just want to thank God and acknowledge Elder Hopton Blake. He is now the Bible instructor for the conference, and so he is not limited to this church. The reason why he will be resident here is because his immediate supervisor, Pastor Nemhard, is at this church. So that's why you will see him here, Elder Green. You will see him still here, but acknowledge this fact, that he doesn't belong to only you now. I just wanted that. Sharon is caring, right? No, I didn't hear that. Sharon is caring, right? And so, yes, you have to share him with the churches in the region. And I know that the Lord will bless him in a mighty way, and his spouse, and Pastor Dunchy and his spouse, who is now, I believe, nursing his son. Isn't that wonderful? Yeah, his son, wow. Pastor Joel Nemhard was right. You know, I did not get the formula for girls. So I only have three boys. And that is what the Lord blessed me with. And I thank God. I pray that one day they'll bring the girls to me. You know, they'll bring good wives who will look after me and love me. Because boys only love their mama. Boys love their mamas. I know. Anyway, today my task here is to share the word of God with you and praise team and surrounded. Surrounded, my goodness, they sing. Wow. God be praised. Well, Central has always been blessed with great musicians. I remember way back, Pastor Wayne Martin time, I remember. When, my goodness, the praise team was, all the seniors and all the folks were involved in that. And I thank God that it continues to be that a baton has been passed and you continue to bless us. My task is to share with you the word of God briefly, and I bring you greetings from the conference, the leadership, and the team there. I know that God continues to bless each and every one of you, and also to thank you for your faithfulness. To thank you for your faithfulness during this pandemic, because were it not for you, where will we have been? Thank you, and we pray that you will continue to be faithful to the task that God has placed before you with your talents and with your time and with your treasure. The Lord will richly bless you. Today, I want us to look at something that is so key. You see, there are so many of us who are in the church, but at the same time have not experienced that full joy of salvation. There are so many of us who are in that intersection of being in the church, doing religious things, and still not experiencing that joy in the Lord. And so, that theologian, Frederick Buckner, he said something. He writes that salvation is an experience first and doctrine second. Salvation is an experience first and doctrine second. Some of us are so into arguing about theological things, arguing about biblical things, arguing about whether vaccine is mark of the beast, or all kinds of nonsense that we get into, and we fail to experience the joy of full salvation. And so it is that in Chip Ingram, in his book Living on the Edge, challenges actually readers to experience Christianity in a way that God intended. And what he does is that he provides an actual profile of a disciple. You know, Jesus said, by this you will know that you are my disciple. John 13:35. By this you will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. And he talks about that relational, grace-based, and actual faith-focused, relational, grace-based, faith-focused focused discipleship, that practical way of living as a Christian. And so, in this, I would like us to really understand the fact that we may be a church, we may be inside the church, but still fail to really experience that joy. And it's my prayer that we will look at this short pericope, this narrative here, and we can glean a few things from it before we leave. Father, please take full control. May your will and your way, and you be done. And use these clay lips of mine. And please, Father, let them move at the impulse of your love. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. John chapter 5, you know, Johannine writings is something that I like. I worked with a theologian for 3-4 years before he left for biblical research. So there is something about theology that I enjoy, but I don't live there, if you understand what I mean. I enjoy it, but I don't live there. I like to live on the practical side of theology as well. The praxis is more important. But then, this happened that John's writings is something that is so dear to me. Johannine writings. And so, John chapter 5, John writes something there that I want us to read and then glean. So if you allowed your Bible to travel with you, please just turn wherever you are, and our online church, we just want to acknowledge and thank you for being present, and thank you for always showing up at church, albeit online. You are needed at Central. I know that we could have scrolled and gone to other churches, but you are at Central, and may God bless you for being here, and may you continue to be present in your church all the time. John chapter 5. We'll be reading from 1 through to 8, maybe 9, but we'll stay at 1 to 8. And it says that after this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there was in Jerusalem by the sheep gate a pool, which is called in Hebrew Bethesda, having 5 porches. And in these lay a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water. Then whoever steps in first after stirring of the water was made well, whatsoever disease he had. Now a certain man was there who had been who had had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he he already had been in that condition for a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be made well? Do you want to be made well?" And the sick man answered and said to him, "Sir, I have no man to put me in the pool when the water is still stirred up. But while I am coming, another steps before me." And Jesus said to him, "Rise, take up your bed and walk." Rise, take up your bed and walk. In fact, verse 9 tells us that immediately the man was made well and took his bed and walked. And it says, John adds, and just so that we will get, this is for some Seventh-day Adventists. Oh, gosh, it says, and that day was the Sabbath. Hallelujah. That day was the Sabbath. And so, you know, looking at this, there are so many things about this text that I know it's been several points has been talked about and theologically discussed. There were at some point people were even doubting, people who were always doubting the Bible, said, no, there wasn't anything like that, Bethesda, that existed. But now, after a long time, they excavated and they found this place. And I was privileged to be there in Jerusalem, where in St. Anne's Church, you will find in there all the porches. And this same place called Bethesda is there. And so this is something that happened. This is a story. It talks about something that happened. And so it is that John tells and narrates that, yes, Jesus came to Jerusalem. Jesus came to Jerusalem in one of the feasts, and he went up to this sheep market. He went up to this lowly place. He went up to this place where the sick were. You see, today, you know, in Hebrew, the Bible tells us that the word Bethesda means, you know, the word Bethesda means the house of mercy. If you look at the Hebrew word, or house of grace, house of mercy, or house of grace. And in Hebrew and in Aramaic as well, it can also mean house of shame or house of disgrace. And so here in that intersection, house of mercy, house of grace, and it can also mean house of shame or house of disgrace. That intersection lies this particular man, and that is where some of us have found ourselves, or some of us find ourselves. In a place, in a position by the poolside, the Bible tells us, where there were so many people, the blind, the lame, and the paralyzed, and they were waiting for the moving of the water. And you know, in NIV, this chapter, verse 4, is actually in the notes, because it's a commentary on what is happening. And so it says, well, an angel, there was something that went through. You know how these stories went through, that, listen, if you are by this lake, and when the waters are stirred up, whatever your infirmity is, when you fall in first, you get healed. And I'm sure they had anecdotal evidence. And so the people from all over the place came and they brought their people. And so they congregated there. And so, yes, you have so many people who are around. It shows, this poolside shows the sinner's position. It shows our need for something, our need for someone. It shows that we are in need. It shows the idea of, you know, those who are religious and those who are rebellious. It shows the professional and the prostitute. It talks about all those who are in need of a savior. And so in this intersection, we find many who are lying down at Bethesda. See, some of us, we can use that analogy to narrate, some of us, it's like a hospital packed with sick people. The blind, and the rumor was that an angel will come and then stir the water. And here some of us, many of us, lying like these men at Bethesda. Some of us are paralyzed by sin. Some of us are paralyzed by certain evil habits and worldliness. Some of us we are dumb, we can't speak, but we babble. We can't speak about the word of God, but we talk about everything else. and everyone else, some of us are deaf to the hearing of the word of God and what God offers us. You see, friends, I want to submit that the suffering ones at Bethesda are still with us today. They are everywhere. We see hopelessness on the streets, and even this pandemic has revealed it so much. The sense of hopelessness that people feel, the sense of loneliness and alone. There are so many people who are home and alone. There are some people who are even married and alone. They are there, waiting for the moving of the waters. There are some, we see some people who are on the streets, we see people who are weeping in their homes, and sometimes even in the church we see. And so our world is a giant, oversized kind of a Bethesda that God is calling you and I to. See, the Bible states that an angel, and so they had all these things going on. Imagine this competition kind of thing, but I will not dwell there. I want to move on to something else. That, you see, all these things that I want to move on to something that Jesus, all these people were there in need of God. And so you and I, we are here in need of God's grace and his mercy. And Jesus, seeing this man who has been there for 30 and 8 years, and it could be some of us, because some of us have been in the church for so long. We have done religious things in the church, and yet we have not experienced that joy of full salvation. We don't experience the joy in being in the Lord, the joy of being forgiven, the joy of being a child of God, the joy of going into the presence of your Father, asking for forgiveness, and the Father giving you forgiveness, the joy of enjoying his presence every day. The joy of, as the hymn writer says, I come to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses, and he walks with me, and he talks with me. That joy, and the joy, oh, that fills my heart as we tarry there. None other has ever known. There are some of us who have not experienced that, but we have been there for so long. We have been in the church for so long, sitting on the periphery, sitting on that intersection, living on that edge of being one foot in the church, one foot outside, and not experiencing the full surrender of being in the presence of God. And so it is that this man who has been there for so many years, Jesus saw him lying there, and he knew he had been in that condition for so long. See, the beautiful thing about Johannine writings is that John over and over again emphasizes that Jesus sees, Jesus knows. Jesus sees, Jesus knows. That God, Jehovah sees, Jehovah knows. Jehovah sees and Jehovah knows. And Jesus could have gone to any one of them, but Jesus chose this particular person. And I'm glad he remained nameless. Wherever a person remained nameless, I know that could be me. That could be me, lying there by the pool of Bethesda. It can be a pool of mercy, or it can be a pool of shame. It depends on the choice that you make. Do you want to be made well? Jesus asked. Do you want to be well? I believe that Jesus did not want to be presumptuous. You know, do you really want to be well? Because that is, some people will look at it, why would you ask a question like that? Of course he wants to be well, but no, God has given us that power of choice. The choice to be Seventh-day Adventist Christian, remain a Seventh-day Adventist Christian, and still not have that joy of being in the presence of God. What a shame. You see, Jesus was asking this man, do you really want to be well? Do you want to be well? It was a probing question. Do you want to be well? Do you want to be made well? It was a question that was also personal. Do you want to be well? It was a question that Jesus was probing. It was personal. It was pointed. But at the same time, it was a practical question. I can't force you. Jesus cannot push you. God has given you that power of choice to decide on which side you want to be, on God's side or on the devil's side. And so you have that power of choice. And so do you want to be whole? Do you want to be well? Do you wish to stop repeating the same mistakes that has put you in a cycle of sinfulness? Do you want to repeat that full anger over that you keep brooding over? Do you want to repeat that full, things that you have in there? Do you want to repeat that same thing? Do you want to play on how you have been hurt in the past? Do you want to play that at the back of your mind? Do you want that to cripple you? Do you really want to be made well? Do you want to be freed from your yesterday? Do you want to be freed of your past? Do you want to be happy? Do you want to have that fullness of joy, the joy of full salvation? Do you want to be made well? Jesus is asking some of us, or all of us. The final analysis is a question that only you can answer. Can start by asking yourself, what do I need to be healed of? What is it that you need to be healed of? What sort of thing do you need to change about your life in order to be whole? What is it that you need? You see, in Desire of Ages, Sister White talks about this man that he was there. Jesus pointedly looked at him. And Ministry of Whole Healing talks about that. And Jesus looked at him and he had compassion on him. And he posed that question. Jesus knew that this man truly wanted healing. He had been there too long, unhappy with his situation, and wanted to make change. See, all we need to do is to show an interest, raise our hand, and God will grab you. That's all we need. Instead of living in our past hurt, lying on the edge, on the precipice of greatness of what God can do in our lives, we wallow in our yesterday's pain. We sit in our yesterday's debt. We sit in our yesterday's failure. And we brood over it. Jesus is asking you, do you want to be made well? See, some of us are paralyzed by certain sinful habits. And God is asking us, do you want to be made well? Do you want to be made well? And then it's interesting that this sick man came and he continued, verse 7. It's interesting. He says that he answered and said, "Sir, I have no man to put me in the water when the water is stirred up, and while I am coming, another steps forward before me." You see, this is where most of us will love to be, love to remain, and love to stay. We like to always blame others for our shortcomings. We like to sometimes blame our parents for not giving us enough. We like to blame our parents. We like to blame our teacher. Imagine if you are making C and you are not applying yourself, "Oh, the teacher doesn't like me." No, you probably didn't take time to study. Oh, you didn't take time. I'm telling all the young people now. You didn't take time to go to the teacher and say, "Teacher, you were teaching this, but I don't understand it. Can you help me?" And they are ready to help you. So don't sit in your corner. No, God is ready to help you. Your teachers are ready to help you. And so he says, "Well, you know, I have been here." Jesus posed that a direct question. Do you want to be healed? And then he goes on, "Yes, sir. Yes, no man is here to put me in the water." But I like one thing. This man acknowledged his deficiency. And so it is. On our own, we can do nothing. On your own, you can do nothing. But it is by the grace of God, by the grace of God, that you and I will be able to move towards God. Just lift up our eyes and lift up our hands and say, Lord, I'm here. I need help. And so he acknowledges his deficiency. He realized that no one will help him, his inability to save himself. He realized that, no, there is something that I can't do myself. I need help. But sometimes some of us love living on the edge. You know, sometimes some people can interpret this living on edge as some people who like action, some people who like, you know, dangerous things. But no, I want to make the point that the point is simply this, that there are some of us who live in that intersection of being in a place where we know it's not giving us full joy, or we are not exhibiting our full potential, but we still lie there. Or sometimes we are sitting there and we are wallowing over whatever problem we have. Because of this problem, I can't move forward. Because of that problem, I can't go forward. Because of my yesterday pain, I have to stay stuck here. No, God is saying no. And so here he was. Here he was. Well, you want to be made whole. And said, well, there were so many people that I really want. I really want, but something happens. They step ahead of me, and I am not able to get to where I want to get to. See, sometimes we like to play the victim role, the innocent victim, to blame others for wounding or offending us, or for keeping us stuck. Today, I want somebody to understand that no one except God should have monopoly of your life. But how you should feel, don't give people that opportunity, that power over your life that cripples you from becoming what God wants you to be. Don't let anyone, you see, we like to complain, and we like to look for excuses rather, and to note that, you know, sometimes the way my parents brought me up, you know, they has done me wrong. I didn't get the right spouse. I deserve better. It's not my fault. Why me? How could, you know, I could have had been fully alive and well, but such and such a bad, such bad thing happened to me. And so I am stuck here. I'm forever on the edge of healing. With healing so close, but never quite making the move. Healing can be so close, and yet never making the move. You know, there are so many people who are in psychiatric hospitals. If only they can allow their yesterday pain, they will be relieved. There are so many of us who may be on pills, hypertensive pills, that if only we pause to forgive someone who caused our past pain, we will be free of that disease. There is somebody here that somebody has probably disappointed, caused you so much pain. You invested so much into them, and they turn around and they disappoint you. Do you want to be made well? Jesus is asking. Do you want to be made well? You know, it's easy. Easy to wallow in our pain, but it causes more harm to us, because sometimes it's comfortable and everybody will come, oh, poor you, yeah, he was so wicked to you, oh, she was so nasty to you, and then you feel like that, you want that attention. But God wants you to move from that place. And so he was talking about all of this. Well, time is gone. So he said, and so this is after talking about all of this, the excuses that he was given. Jesus knows that we like to give excuses. He knows that we love to give excuses. And so today, I want to give us three things that Jesus said. Three things. Maybe, and then we will go home. Three things. Number one, Jesus said to him, Jesus is saying to you and I today, rise, get up, take up your mat, and walk. Rise, take up your mat, and walk. Rise, take up your mat, and walk. Rise from your spiritual stupor. Rise from your yesterday pain. Rise from being an unconsecrated Christian. Rise from that hurt. Rise from it. By his grace, you can rise. Jesus is saying, don't stay there. Don't stay on that edge. Don't stay in that intersection. No, there is something that I have for you. You can do better than this. I have a better day for you. I have a better opportunity for you. I have something waiting at the other end for you. And I'm encouraging you to rise. Rise from your pain. Rise from your hurt. Rise from your disappointment. Rise from your anger. Rise from your jealousy. And then move on. There is something that I have for you. He's telling us to rise. He calls us to rise up. And walk as faithful Christians and faithful servants, faithful stewards. Rise up and walk in the newness of life. And you know, that's so rise. That's number one thing. Don't stay there. Brothers and sisters, whatever it is that is keeping you stuck, God is saying, no, don't stay there. There is something better. There's a better tomorrow. Look at the horizon. Look to me. Hold my hand. I will pull you from there and take you to another level. So rise. And then he talks about walk. Rise. Take up your mat. See, in those words, he was saying something very important, I believe. Do not make any provision to go back on what you have done. Many people fail right here, friends. Go home, and that little rum. Somebody didn't hear me. Little rum you have there, you know, before you have your nice jerk chicken. Well, I'll tell you, I am not vegetarian. I'll tell you right up. I'm a vegetarian. I love fish. And before you have that meal, just have a little thought, you know, just for the stomach's sake. But he said, rise, take up your mat. Whatever it is that is making it comfortable for you to live in that territory, get rid of it. Go home, get rid of that drug. Go home and burn those bridges. Go home and burn those relationships. People that always will call you, have you heard? No, it's about time you put a call, you know, thing to them. When they call you, say, no, not this time. I want to be with Jesus. There are people who are destroying your relationship with God. There are people who are destroying your marriage. There are people who are destroying you. And there are people who are putting things in your mind. Say, no, get up, walk, take up your mat. Take up what is it? What it is that is making you comfortable to live on that edge, to live in that intersection. Remove that thing. And that's Hebrews 12 tells us, Hebrews 12 too. You know, that thing said, forgetting those things, all those besetting sins, Paul tells us, all those things that weighs us down, things that weighs, all the weights, he's telling us, no, just get up, remove those things. Take up your mat. Take up your mat because you can easily go and lie on it again. But if you take it away, something will happen. See, you probably, you know, cut off any possibility of going back there. Cut off any possibility of going back there. Back there into that toxic relationship,
He comes with a sweet mouth, and he wants to go back to that abuse, back there, to wallowing over people who verbally abuse you, or maybe I dare say sexually abused you, harmfully, back there. Take up that mat and walk. Walk. What does it mean to walk? The third thing, do not expect to be carried. There are some of us who want to be carried. No, it says walk. It means live in my presence. If you live in the presence of God day by day, day by day, God will help you to become the best that he wants you to be. It's never about you. It's about God moving you forward. He says, no, don't stay there marking time. No, begin to walk. Keep living in my presence, and I will make you what I want to make you. If Jesus gives you the power to rise, Jesus is the only one who can also give you the power to walk every day. To keep going, one day at a time. You may not be perfect. You will not be perfect. And don't look at left or look at right. Just keep walking with him. And the things of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. So God is calling us to action, my brothers and sisters. He's calling us to inwardly die to ourselves. He's calling us to get rid of our excuses. He's calling us never to get ourselves bogged down with religious traditions, things that can really hurt us. He's calling us to leave behind all perceptions, all deceptions, and all pain. He's calling us, no. He said, rise, get up, rise, take your mat, get your mat up, no. Get rid of the habits, the attitude, the people that are destroying your life. And connect to Jesus. Disconnect from your old friends sometimes. Old culture. Old pain that you dwell on over and over and over. See, there are some of us, there's a go-to place in our mind. That we go to, that the devil will resurrect all the pain, and we feel so stuck, dejected, and thinking and looking around, thinking, maybe I am not good enough. But God is telling you today, it's your choice. Rise. It's your choice. Rise. Get up. Take all the baggage and the garbage and the pain. Begin walking with me. And I will peel it off. Take it from you. Unburden you. And make you what you ought to be. Get up and do something productive. Instead of criticizing, be part of the solution. Put your gifts and talents to good use and allow God to take full reins. Friends, it is so sweet to trust in Jesus. Just to take him at his word. Just to rest upon his promise. Just to know that Jesus, thus says the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him. How I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. A story is told by Tony Campolo. You may have heard this story before. Tony Campolo is a Christian writer, and Tony Campolo talks and narrates this story of a church. He went to speak somewhere, and a lady came with her husband, and the husband was diagnosed with cancer, terminal cancer, end-stage cancer. The husband was so angry, and Tony spent some time and prayed with them. They went home, and one day Tony said he was there, and the phone rang. And the phone said, oh, you don't remember me, but I came to this and so place, and you prayed for myself and my husband. And she continued to say, well, he died. The phone was so quiet, but she continued, said, oh, don't feel bad. Said, Tony said he felt terrible. I said, no, don't feel bad. You know, when we came to you, that church, he was filled with anger. He was filled with pain. He knew he was going to be dead in a few short period, and he hated God. He was 58 years old, and he wanted to see his children and his grandchildren grow up. He was angry. And this all-powerful God did not take away his sickness and heal him. He will lie in bed and curse God. The more his anger grew towards God, the more miserable he was to everybody around him. It was an awful thing to be in his presence. That is the husband's presence. But the lady told Tony, you know, after you prayed, Tony, a peace had come upon him and a joy had come upon him. Tony, the last 3 days had been the best days of our lives. We have laughed. We have read scripture. We prayed. Oh, they've been wonderful years. And I call to thank you for laying hands on him, for praying for healing for him. And she said something that was incredibly profound. She said, he wasn't cured, but he was healed. He wasn't cured, but he was healed. There are some of us that all we need is the healing touch of God. It's so sweet to trust Jesus, my friends, because he's ready to take us and mold us and remold us into something beautiful. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you that you love us so much that you identify us even from our deadness selves and the place of our lameness, a place of our comfort. And you are calling us to get up and rise. Rise into a new day in your presence. Rise to a new day of joy. Rise to an experiential knowledge of what salvation feels like, and understand that we should not leave our comfortable spots there, but allow you to clean us up as we walk with you. So take full reins of your daughter, your son, somewhere who may need you, Father. We all need you. Help that somebody will move away from living on the edge, but have a meaningful relationship with you. We thank you for hearing us. We thank you for presenting and for relieving us from our past. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, be and abide with you. May he guide and guard you in your going out and in your coming in. May he present you faultless before the throne of grace with exceeding joy. May the God Almighty be with you and your family, both now and forevermore. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you.
Rise, take up your mat, and walk. Georgia,
what a wonderful message.
But I'm ready to rise out of my spiritual stupor. I'm ready to walk with Jesus Christ.
That was a wonderful message. Thank you, Pastor. We were blessed today.
Amen.
My takeaway, Peter, where Pastor talked about, don't give people power over you.
Amen, amen. My takeaway is get rid of the things that are making it comfortable for you to remain in your spiritual stupor. Get rid of your man.
Exactly. And he also talked about we fail to experience the joy of full salvation.
Amen. Stop living on the edge of shame and mercy. Experience joy and healing in Jesus Christ.
Amen. I hope you were blessed today. Those that are here in our audience and those that are online, we encourage you to continue to come out and support us each and every Sabbath. Continue to share that link with your families and friends.
Amen. If you were touched, let people know.
Exactly. And also, please like. Please click on that like button and like our page so that others will be able to see and come out and want to worship with us. And those that are in the audience, if you have your phone, take it out and like our page. Those that are online, please like our page. Like Sister Marcia said, she got the link from someone. That's how she became a member. Continue to share the link. And let us congratulate our newly baptized members today. I'm Amen. So happy. Welcome, everyone. Let's give them a round of applause. Amen. Amen. We're so happy for them today.
Amen.
Well, this is it, Peter. The this end of another Sabbath. It is also our long weekend.
Amen. Please enjoy the long weekend safely.
That is correct. Enjoy, and we will see you next Sabbath here, same place, same time. May God continue to bless you.
Amen. Be blessed.
We pray that you have a wonderful rest of the Sabbath day. Let the glory of the Lord
Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King rise among us. Let it rise. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King, oh yes, rise among us, let it rise.
Oh,
oh, oh, let it rise. Oh, let it rise.
Let the songs of the Lord
rise among us.
Let the songs of the Lord
rise among us.
Oh, let the praises of our King, oh yes,
rise among us. Let it rise.
Let the songs of the Lord
rise among us.
Let the songs of the Lord
rise among us.
Let the praises of our King, oh yes,
rise among us.
Let it rise. Come on, oh, oh, oh.
Oh, 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 oh. Let it rise. Oh, 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 oh. Let it rise.
One more time. Let the glory of the Lord,
Let the glory of the Lord
rise among us.
Let the glory of the Lord
rise among us.
Oh, let the praises of our King, oh yes,
rise among us. Let it rise.
Let the glory of the Lord
rise among us.
Let the glory of the